You're on.
Am I on? Let's see if I can, I can't say it, I'm just gonna go.
Yeah, there's no connection.
No connection.
At all.
But that's all I mean, but I'm, this poem I'm gonna talk about is a relatively, it was an older poem, but it began and ended with one word, not O, a different word. And the poem is called Parsley. It's, and I chose it because it seemed to, the way it came about was such a mixture of serendipity, doggedness, despair, and serendipity again, and all of that. And so I thought I'd try to share that with you. And I have a couple of visual aids, so they're not great, just a couple. Quirkiness, too, is in there. Let me tell you about the poem, because the poem begins with, the poem begins with fact. And that's always tricky if you're a poet, if you get something with fact instead of just imagination. But I didn't choose to write the poem either. The poem is based on an incident that happened in the Dominican Republic in 1937. And the general, Rafael Trujillo, had 20,000 Haitian cane workers executed because they could not pronounce the Spanish word for parsley. They couldn't roll their R's. The Haitians worked side by side with the Dominicans. They spoke of the French-based Creole, where, of course, there are come out more, but a Frenchman would speak an R. And so this word, which he decided he chose all on his own, parson, has an R, and their R's came out as L's. And I first came across this incredible that back in the 80s, I was in Berlin, of all places, to discover something like this, but I was at a little breakfast get-together of writers in an office bookstore in Berlin. My husband was a member of the bookstore as a novelist, and so we were sitting there, and I was kind of bored. Everyone was talking, gossiping, as writers would do. And I just looked across the room and I saw this green title on a white background, and it was the German word for parsley, which is Petersilie. And I thought, what the heck? It wasn't in the cooking section. You see, so I thought, well, that doesn't make any sense. So I just stared at it for about 15 minutes, and then I finally got up, found a hole in the conversation, and got up, and I went over and looked at it, and it was actually a book documenting a lot about the Dominican Republic, but the jacket cover text told the story that 20,000 Asian blacks had to, they got up and they, each of them spoke the word Penahil, and those where it came out Penahil died. And that haunted me for about, and I worked on this book for about 2 years. I put it in my notebook, I couldn't wrap my head around it. I thought this was too large for a poem. I didn't know how to enter it. So I'll read the poem now, and then I'll tell you a little bit about how I entered it, and then we'll go on. It's in two parts. Each part has a title. Parsley, the cane fields. There is a parrot imitating spring in the palace, its feathers parsley green. Out of the swamp, the cane appears to haunt us, and we cut it down. El General searches for a word. He is all the world there is. Like a parrot imitating spring, we lie down screaming as rain punches through, and we come up green. We cannot speak an R. Out of the swamp, the cane appears, and then the mountain we call in whispers, Catalina. The children gnaw their teeth to arrowheads. There is a parrot imitating spring. El General has found his word, Perejil, who says it lives. He laughs, teeth shining out of the swamp. The cane appears in our dreams, lashed by wind and streaming. And we lie down. For every drop of blood, there is a parrot imitating spring. Out of the swamp, the cane. palace. The word the generals chosen is parsley. It is fall, when thoughts turn to love and death. The general thinks of his mother, how she died in the fall, and he planted her walking cane at the grave, and it flowered, each spring stolidly forming four star blossoms. The general pulls on his boots. He stomps to her room in the palace, the one without curtains, the one with a parrot in a brass ring. As he paces, he wonders, who can I kill today? And for a moment, the little knot of screams is still. The parrot, who has traveled all the way from Australia in an ivory cage, is coy as a widow, practicing spring. Ever since the morning his mother collapsed in the kitchen while baking skull-shaped candies for the Day of the Dead, the general has hated sweets. He orders pastries brought up for the bird. They arrive dusted with sugar on a bed of lace. The knot in his throat starts to twitch. He sees his boots the first day in battle, splashed with mud and urine, as a soldier falls at his feet, amazed. How stupid he looked at the sound of artillery. I never thought it would sing, the soldier said, and died. Now the general sees the fields of sugar cane lashed by rain and streaming. He sees his mother's smile, the teeth gnawed to arrowheads. He hears the Haitians sing without R's as they swing the great machetes. Catalina, they sing, Catalina, mi madre, mi amor de muerte. God knows his mother was no stupid woman. She could roll an R like a queen. Even a parrot can roll an R. In the bare room, the bright feathers arch in a parody of greenery as the last pale crumbs disappear under the blackened tongue. Someone calls out his name in a voice so like his mother's, a startled tear splashes the tip of his right boot. My mother, my love and death. The general remembers the tiny green sprigs men of his village wore in their capes to honor the birth of a son. He will order many this time to be killed for a single beautiful word. So that is the poem, and it began with that word, and it began with that whole incredibly unimaginable event. And I did write down the details in my notebook, my own rule of notebooks is just that if it stops during my tracks, put it in there, don't question it. Don't try to second guess it. Don't try to figure out what it's about necessarily. And there it stayed, and I would browse through my notebook and say, I can't do anything with this. What am I going to? And I didn't even want to do anything. But at the same time, it haunted me. Enter a little bit of serendipity and fate, in that what happened after that was that I went off my life. I went to my to Arizona, where I was teaching at the time, and some friends of ours had invited us to a Thanksgiving dinner on the Pima Indian Reservation with some other friends. And so while we were getting our stuff together in Betty's trailer, she had a parrot, and the parrot was absolutely obnoxious, as many parrots can be. And this parrot would just bite you if you came near it, but it also imitated anything in the world. It would imitate the faucet dripping, and then Betty would run over there and then it would laugh, you know. And it was many colors, but it had a really beautiful underside to its wing, which was green, and it was parsley green. And I kept staring at it fascinated. Then I realized what I was staring at, that it was this green color. And so I went to the bathroom, which is a great place to jot things on your notebook, and I went to the bathroom and I wrote down parents' friends of parsley green, and that's all I wrote. And I came back out, and I had Thanksgiving dinner and all that. After that, I thought, okay, you can enter this through something small. But I had no idea why the parent was there and what it was doing, what it had to do with the general. And so the next step, the recourse, was research. And so I began to research everything I could about parents, but also about this event. because at that time I couldn't find any, I could find very little substantiation that actually occurred. And after I did find that, then I started describing this parent. And there were many, many failed attempts. At this point, I have to tell you that I have a great thing for color. This is one of my quirks. I love color, and I love it in all manifestations. I have a box of 64 crayons on my desk, just to look at them sometimes. I just love it. And one of the things that I do when I write is I don't write in sequence, I write in fragments. And so things, I might write the second stanza of something and then work on something else and then come back. And so I had all these little bits and pieces of something for this poem, but I didn't know where it was going to go. I put all my fragments in colored, in colored little folders like this. This is my only visual. And mainly because I don't like to file them according to theme. I don't know what the theme is. I'll let the critics figure that out. But I can get up, to write on a certain day and think, I feel like going to the green folder. Or I feel blue today, or I feel red. So this stayed actually in the yellow folder for a long time. It did not stay in green. I don't even know if it ever went to green. And I don't know why that is. I'm not going to question the news in that sense. But what happened then was that I worked and I tried to figure out how to get into this poem. And I thought to myself, one of the things that's happening is that this word Parsley is being said over and over again, over and over again by each person as they came up. And I thought, what better way to kind of get at that repetition than to go to form? And so you might have heard the first part of the poem is a villanelle. There are lines that repeat. There's a parrot imitating spring in the palace. And so that repetition happens over and over again. The second part, I decided to be just some totemic things that kept popping out of me, which were green, parsley, general, and do a sestina, which is a form made in its own for masochists. And I've never written a good sestina in my life, but I keep trying. And so it's basically a six-line stanza, six of those with one tercet at the end, and the N word is always one of those six words that you've chosen. And then they repeat it, they change in a very complicated pattern. So I tried that and it failed utterly, but it got me started. It got me, somehow the general's mother got in there, and I suddenly realized that what haunted me was that the general was creative in thinking up the word parsley. I had nothing to do. That he was creative, and that bugged me. It bugged me that evil could be creative. And as I began to work more on the story, I realized I had to give him a backstory himself and his backstory. He had to make him somewhat sympathetic to us, because if you can't see the humanity of this gem, seen as a human being, we dismiss his evil. So I kept working on that, and I got the first, the villanelle worked pretty well. I got hung up because I thought, is there really a parrot who's parsley green, completely green? I thought, I had to have that effect, it had to be true. And I couldn't tell. This was before the age of Google and internet, and so I didn't know what to do, and I was hung up on that until one day, that's my beautiful piece of symphony. I had a student call me up and said she was going to be late to class because she was working in a pet shop, and the person who was training the parrot, I kid you not, had not come in, and she had to stay with the parrot. And I said, couldn't you bring the parrot to class? And she said, yeah, I could do that. And I said, okay, fine, bring the parrot to class. And so she brought this parrot to class. It was not completely green. It was a very well-behaved parrot. It walked up and down the table, took everybody's pencils and rearranged them. And we had it was a great class, and she thanked me profusely, and I said, well, there's one thing you could do for me now that I let you bring the parrot in. And she said, what? I said, can you find out if there's a completely green parrot? And she says, oh yeah, no problem. And she had the answer within a day. And there was, and it was from Australia, which brought Australia in there. And that's how the poem began to come together. At the end, I simply just wrote the last part. I ditched the sestina, and just actually wrote prose until the prose became poetry. And then I went back and fixed it together. But that's how that poem happened. So I'm going to stop right there.